Welcome to the second day of class, first day of this class. This is neurobiology of pain. Everybody in the right place? Yeah. All right, cool. I'm Ted Price. I'm teaching this class. We have a TA. He's right here, Andy Wang Zhu. Yeah. Andy is in my lab. He's a second year PhD student. Yes, he deserves applause. Andy will be the TA. We'll set up review sessions at some point. We also have Mark Chavez, who's here, shooting video. We are going to try something new this semester. We're not only going to record the lectures, we're also going to do video. So, and I'll post the video. Mark is going to be like recording me and also integrating the slides into the video, right, Mark? Thumbs up, yeah. So, we're hoping it's going to be pretty cool. We're also, I think, going to put this class on the web to try to, like, there are very few neurobiology of pain classes. I'm going to go into this in the next couple slides, but this is one of the only ones, and we're going to kind of use this to publicize the great stuff that we do here at UTD and the unique expertise we have in areas like pain neurobiology, right? So, that's what I study. It's what my PhD is in pharmacology and neuroscience, and the area I worked in was cannabinoid pharmacology and pain. I did a postdoc at McGill University studying pain in the McGill Center for Pain Research, which is the biggest pain research center in the world still. All of my training from PhD level on has been in the pain area. I was a professor. My first job was as a professor at University. Well, actually, my first job was at Circuit City in the warehouse. My first job was at Blockbuster. I should remember that correctly. My second job was Circuit City in the warehouse, where they had no air conditioning. I was a professor at University of Arizona School of Medicine for 7 years, and then I came back to UTD. 4 years ago now. I graduated from UTD in 1997. I started here in 1993, and I was a neuroscience major. So how many of you guys are neuroscience majors? Cool. I was the first person to graduate from this university with a Bachelor's of Science in Neuroscience. Did you know that? Yeah, that's cool too, right? So there were four of us actually that year, but I was the first one to walk across the stage. I forgot to do something else, and that's to turn on the recorder. So I'm going to turn on the recorder, because I'm also going to record in case some tragedy happens with Mark. So we have recorded lectures. You never know, Mark. You were coughing earlier in the week. Okay, so today is going to be kind of the intro to the class. I see many of you guys recognize, actually a huge number of you guys I recognize. I assume that's because you took cellular neuroscience at some point for me, and or you guys work in my lab, so thank you guys for taking the class. Today what I'm going to do is to give you a really brief introduction first to the structure of the class, how the exams and everything are going to work. That's what we'll start with. Then we'll go into just some really basic stuff about pain, and then I'm going to tell you kind of my story about pain research and how I got involved in this to give you guys some context. I also want to get you guys thinking about some things today that I hope that you will ask me about throughout the semester as we go through the basic neurobiology of pain, medicines that are currently used to treat pain, and hopefully you guys will be thinking about better ways to treat pain. So pain is not very well treated. We use opioids primarily to treat pain, and opioids don't actually do a very good job. I mean, they're extraordinarily effective acutely for pain, but after a couple days, they're not so good anymore. They don't work for most people that have chronic pain. For neuropathic pain, they don't work very well. There are lots of good reasons to develop new pain drugs, and that's what my primary goal in my professional life is to do. But I have more than a professional life, and as you guys that were in my cellular neuroscience class know, my wife was pregnant. On December 28th, we had our second kid. He's there. It's Max. He's now 11 days old. No, 10 days old. No, 12 days old. 12 days old. That's my wife, and that's Penelope, who's 2.5 years old. And that's our Christmas tree, which is fake. So the class is going to be on Tuesdays and Thursdays, as you know. Okay. I don't care if you come to class. I hope that you enjoy the class and that you want to be here. If you don't want to be here, you don't need to be here. We're going to be recording it. It'll be available. I also make audio recordings. We will post those on eLearning. The slides are all already posted on eLearning. So, you know, again, I work hard to give the best lectures I can. I hope that you guys come to lecture because you enjoy it and you get something out of it. If you don't get anything out of it, you don't have to come, okay? We don't take any attendance. There's no quizzes. We will have 5 exams. It's basically the same for those of you that took cellular neuroscience with me. It works the same way. 4 exams on the material. The course is broken into quarters, okay? The structure is already on eLearning. All the lectures, again, are already posted on eLearning. So we'll have those 4 exams. All of them will be multiple choice. They're all going to be in the testing center. Hopefully you guys know the testing center has moved. It's over in the SLC building or whatever that thing's called over across Synergy Park North. Yeah, SPC, right? Anyway, something like SPN, that's right. Also, the exam will be, there'll be a window during which you can take the exam, okay? So basically, the idea is that the exam window will open on a Wednesday and it'll close on a Sunday, okay? So you have four or five days to take the exam. So you can sign up during that window to take the exam. We have the honor code at the university, okay? So once you take the exam, if you go and tell everybody else what's on the exam, that's a violation of the honor code, you fail, all right? That's the deal. So I try to make it easy for you. Don't betray me, all right? Okay, the comprehensive exam is comprehensive, but all the questions will be taken from the previous exams, okay? So they'll all be questions that you've seen before from those 4 exams. It'll be about 50 questions. Each one of them counts for about 20%, or exactly 20% of the grade. I'll do curves if they're needed. In cellular neuroscience, curves are always needed. In this class, I've never needed to use a curve, so I don't anticipate we'll have a curve this semester. If every single one of you guys gets an A, that's fine with me. I'd be thrilled because it means that you would learn something important about pain. So, and Andy is the TA. He's there. If you have logistical questions about the class that are not answered by the syllabus, please ask either Andy or I. Okay, so how can you excel in this class? Well, there's no book, okay? There are readings that I posted. Those are all from the primary literature. I don't expect you guys to read those, but if you see something on a slide, a figure from a paper, and you say, gosh, that's really interesting, I really want to know more, you can find them in the papers. I put the reference on all the slides, and then you can go find the paper. It's listed under those additional readings, okay? So I don't think I missed anything. Everything should be there. If you're not familiar with reading the primary literature, we will do that a little bit in this class, so I'll try to talk more extensively about the context of those papers, especially as we get further into the class. In the fourth part of the class, we will cover some papers that are more geared towards clinical trials or that are clinical trials, okay? So there will be some primary reading at the end of the class. There's also a book that you can order. You can get it used on Amazon for about $5. Understanding Pain by Fernando Severo. Fernando Severo was my postdoc mentor. He was a professor at McGill University. He's now retired. It's a terrific book. It's written for a lay audience, so you don't need to have any expertise in this area a priori to understand the book. It's a good introduction to the class, and it follows the same kind of progression as the class, okay? It's not required, but I do think it's useful. And Fernando is a luminary in the field. He was the president of the International Association for the Study of Pain, actually when I worked in his lab. He's extraordinarily well-known, perhaps the best known electrophysiologist to have worked in the pain field in the last 25 years. So he knows a lot about it, and it's a really well-written book. It's also relatively short and cheap. Okay, so I'm not gonna go through this in detail, but the topics that we're going to cover in this class are going to run the gamut from basic cellular neurobiology to clinical pain syndromes, their treatments, and designing clinical trials. Okay? It may seem like it's relatively daunting, but I'm going to do everything I can to make it as simple and straightforward as possible. Right? How many of you guys want to go to medical or dental or nursing or PA or something like that graduate school? Almost all of you. How many of you want to do basic research? How many don't want to do either of those things? Just a very small number. Okay, cool. You guys are still going to get something out of this class because everybody cares about pain, right? It's an interesting topic. For those of you guys that want to either go on to be a clinician of whatever sort or a basic researcher, I hope I'm going to provide you with information that you're not going to get in graduate school. So I came here from a medical school. I did my PhD in a medical school. I did my postdoc in a medical school. So I was in the Department of Pharmacology at University of Texas Health Science Center, San Antonio. For my PhD, I was in the anesthesiology department when I was at McGill. I was in the pharmacology department at Arizona College of Medicine. At Arizona College of Medicine, I taught the entire pain curriculum in the neuro block. Anybody care to guess how many hours it was? Two. You can't learn everything that you need to know about this topic in 2 hours. It's impossible, okay? So what is the primary reason that people seek medical attention? Pain. What is the most costly medical problem in the United States today? Pain. So, what is the leading cause of death among young people? I heard somebody say something.
Opioid.
Yeah, opioid overdose, actually. Okay. All right, so those things are very intertwined. Opioids, of course, are used to treat pain, right? So, my real goal in this course is to do what I couldn't do in medical school, and that is to get you guys the education that you need to have to be able to care for people that have pain, okay? Most of those people that have pain are going to have some other underlying issue, at least at first. In many cases, they're going to continue to have pain well after that underlying issue is gone. And for most physicians, it's a great mystery why that happens. In fact, they used to usually just ascribe these kind of problems to hysteria, right? Well, we now know that it's not hysteria. It essentially is neuronal plasticity, right? So when it boils down to it, this is really a course about neuronal plasticity. We're going to be talking about pain, and I hope that for those of you that go on to be clinicians, at the very least, it'll make you more compassionate for people that you'll take care of that have pain. At the best, hopefully it gets you interested in this as a career, because it's a huge problem, and drives you to do either clinical or basic research that can come up with better ways to treat people, okay? My background is pharmacology, so I'm gonna fully expose my bias in this course and talk to you guys about drug treatment, okay? And it's gonna focus on that. That's my bias, okay? Don't get the impression that because that's what we're gonna focus on in this course, that's the only way you can treat pain. It's just not true, right? But that's what I know, that's where my expertise lies, and that's what I'm primarily going to present to you. If you have questions about, you know, what are the ways you can think about treating pain, feel free to ask and we can discuss it, okay? So, let's see, I think that covers most of the stuff on here. My little clicker thing is gone, so I have to buy a new.
I'm more tethered than I like to be.
All right, so, pain, of course, has many different forms, different causes, etc. The real issue with pain, which is defined as by the International Association for the Study of Pain as an unpleasant sensory and emotional experience associated with actual or potential tissue damage or described in terms of such damage, is not really acute pain. That's not really the problem. The problem is when this continues to happen even when there is no physical threat or tissue damage, etc., right? When you continue to feel pain even after tissue injury has gone away. So I am in this course going to talk a lot about animal models that we use to study pain, and in animals I'm not going to refer to pain as pain, okay, in most cases.
I will refer to it as nociception, okay?
So what is the difference between nociception and pain? Pain is really an emotion, okay? You have to have an integration of the sensory and emotional experience to have pain. Nociception is just the neural process of encoding noxious stimuli, okay? Which we're very good at studying in animal models, which is where we've gotten most of the information I'll talk about in this course, okay? So it's important to know the distinction between nociception and pain. It is very hard to determine whether or not a species that can't speak is in pain. It's also very hard to determine, actually, in humans that can't speak, if they have pain. Then if any of you guys have kids, you know, that's a big issue for the first couple months of their lives. It's also a big issue of people for people at the end of their lives. People with Parkinson's and Alzheimer's disease, for instance, often can't communicate. And it's very hard to know if they have pain or not. And we know that some of these diseases, especially Parkinson's disease, is often associated with very intense pain. So, you know, we need better ways to try to understand this, which is something I'll talk about later in the course. So where does nociception start? It starts with these specialized cells in the peripheral nervous system called nociceptors. And we're going to spend a lot of time in this class talking about these cells. That'll be pretty much the entire focus of the first quarter of the course. And then the third quarter of the course will also focus on these. They are defined as high-threshold sensory receptors of the peripheral somatosensory nervous system that are capable of transducing and encoding noxious stimuli. So we'll go into a lot more detail on them, but I want to make sure you know this term before we get started. So pain, traditionally, has been viewed as a symptom of something else, but this is something that's really changed dramatically in the last, I would say, 25 years, with that accelerating really over the last 10 years. We now know that in many cases that's not the case. Pain is not a symptom of anything. It usually starts as a symptom of something, but those underlying diseases can often be treated and pain can persist. Or pain often has no known cause. We often refer to this as idiopathic, right? We don't know what caused it. This is especially common for things like migraine headache. We have no idea why people started to get migraine, but you know, they clearly have it. Or people that have neuropathic pain where we can't find an underlying nerve injury or a chemotherapeutic treatment or anything like that that caused it, yet they feel intense burning or stinging pain in an extremity all the time, right? So I think that what we now know is, number one, that pain can persist even long after an injury resolves. And my personal view is that persistent pain, this kind of pain, which is the thing that's very hard to treat clinically, is rarely a symptom, but is probably a demonstration that persistent pain is a disease of the nervous system, okay? So one of the primary goals of this course is to get you guys familiar with how these plasticity mechanisms occur, how we might target them, and how that can change your understanding of clinical pain disorders, okay? All right, so obviously, as I just mentioned, pain, as opposed to nociception, is very subjective, and it's both a sensory and emotional experience. And so we're also going to spend a lot of time in this class talking about human functional imaging studies, where we look at the integration of emotional and sensory experience and pain and how that can help us understand better how to potentially treat pain disorders in humans, okay? Which is ultimately the goal, obviously. So another thing that's really important to recognize about chronic pain is that it has a lot of comorbidities. This is just some of them. It can prevent or disturb sleep. It can interfere with cognitive function. Suicide rates are very high in people that have pain. So this idea that pain never killed anybody is not true. Many people actually commit suicide because they're in intractable pain. There are also some emerging studies that suggest that people who have intractable pain and other kinds of diseases, like certain types of cancers, have lower survival rates for reasons that can't be explained by progression of the cancer, okay? So pain has a definitive impact on quality of life and can cause people to try to take their own lives, and also may decrease lifespan in certain cases, okay? So we will talk in the second quarter of the course about how the sensory and emotional experience of pains are integrated and how that can lead to comorbidities like sleep disturbance, like depression, etc. Okay, so pain is not technically a sense, but it's very similar to one. Of course, it has this emotional experience, like I just mentioned. And pain systems really project all throughout the brain. This is another thing we're going to cover in a lot of detail in the second quarter of this course. So the vision system, you know, it projects to the visual cortex. It's pretty specific. But the pain system, it goes to somatosensory cortex. It goes to all the associated somatosensory cortexes. It goes to limbic structures. It goes to prefrontal structures. It goes to most of the hindbrain structures. So it goes basically all over your brain, and that's why it has such a big impact on basically everything in your life, right? So people that have persistent pain are often extraordinarily motivated to try to get rid of that pain. And a big reason for that is because it has such a huge impact on every part of their function. A great example of this, something that Greg Musor will come into this class to talk about in the fourth part of the course, is migraine headache also, right? So people that have migraines essentially make them completely non-functional, right? So it's essentially impossible for these people to do much of anything when they have a migraine. So it is quite literally taking away their life when they're having a migraine attack, okay? So the spread of this system throughout all the other systems in the brain is really amazing, and there's a strong anatomical basis for that, which we'll talk about in the second quarter of the course. How do we measure pain? We typically use, in humans, this what is called the visual analog scale. So we rate pain on a 0 to 10 rating. We will talk about this a lot when we talk about clinical trials in the last part of the course. In some cases, we use this base pain rating scale. This is for people that can't communicate. But we're increasingly also using this in animals that can't communicate. So Jeff Mogul, who's at McGill University, developed what's called the mouse grimace scale, which is based on this. Mice make faces when they're in pain. It turns out rats do also. Horses do. Lots of other animals. Dogs also do, right? So veterinarians are increasingly using this to assess pain. So we'll talk about how we can use these kind of measures to assess pain across species and potentially develop better therapeutics. So how costly is pain? Well, first of all, I think that most, especially young people, don't recognize just how prevalent pain is. This, all of the data here comes from the Institute of Medicine report in 2011, where they looked at the state of pain in the United States. Their findings were that about a third of the United States population suffers from chronic pain, so it's a very prevalent disease. It's extraordinarily costly, so the total cost is between $300 billion and $600 billion per year. That's in medical costs and lost productivity, so it depends on who you ask how high that cost is, but this is higher than the cost of heart disease, diabetes, and cancer combined. So pain treatment and lost productivity is extraordinarily expensive. And this is important to all of us because this primarily affects people that are in the so-called socialized part of our medicine, right? So people that are on Medicare, so the elderly, or people that don't make enough money and qualify for Medicaid, right? So a lot of this cost gets passed on to the general taxpayer. So there's a lot of motivation to do better in terms of treating people. All of that aside, the human suffering is immense, right? This, we're talking about a third of the population. So the total cost is about $2,000 per person per year. Also, a lot of this is in the VA system. So the overall burden is extraordinary. This particular report came out in 2011, and the conclusion of Phil Pizzo, who was the chair of this, was that Pain in America is a public health crisis. Its treatment is a moral imperative, and we need a cultural transformation. I would love to tell you that in the 7 years now since the report was brought out that this has happened, but it hasn't. Much of this is still the same, and we still need this cultural transformation, but my argument would be that what we really need to have is a better basic understanding of how it happens, and we need better therapeutics. If we're really gonna make a difference here, we need better therapeutics. So again, that'll be a major focus of what we talk about in the class, okay? All right, so I'm gonna wrap up this part and then talk about some other things quickly at the end by telling you what the definition of chronic pain is. You would imagine for something that's as prevalent as I just talked about that we would have a clear definition and a clear way to diagnose it, but again, that is also not the case. Chronic pain is simply defined by the duration of time with which people have pain, okay? So the usual definition is anywhere from 3 to 6 months. So if you have pain that persists for 3 to 6 months, that would qualify as chronic pain. This is from a book called The Classification of Chronic Pain, which came from a task force of the International Association for the Study of Pain. I'm not going to read this to you, but it basically bemoans the fact that there's no operational definition of chronic pain, and that we're simply defining it by 3 to 6 months. So again, in this course, I'm going to make an argument to you. You don't have to accept that argument, but my argument is going to be that just defining chronic pain as something that lasts for 3 to 6 months is not actually very useful. It should be defined as a disease of neuronal plasticity, and that we have to figure out ways to assess what the underlying neuronal plasticity is in these people if we're going to have hope of being able to treat it. So I wish I could give you an answer to that. I can't, but what I'm going to try to do is to get you guys thinking about it, and then maybe one day you can go out and come up with a solution to this problem, okay? Okay, so now I'm going to switch to the other slideshow, which has the primary function of telling you about what my lab does to try to solve this problem. And I can't really tell this story without telling you a little bit about the businesses that we've started. So this is going to be a little bit of a mix of what my lab does and what these two companies that we've started. And by we, I'm talking about myself and Greg Dussour, who most of you guys probably know I work pretty closely with, and you guys may have had a class with. How many of you guys have had a class with Greg? Fair number. Okay, cool. So our lab is in BSD. So if you haven't been in the BSD building, it's a beautiful building on the north side of campus. This is my lab a couple years ago. Here's me, here's Greg. And the point of this is to point out the great successes of many undergraduate neuroscience majors at this university to give you guys a little bit of inspiration. I don't know if anybody has met Khadija, but she's now a medical student at UT Southwestern. Andrew is a medical student at Texas Tech. Sid is a medical student at Johns Hopkins. Onoff is a medical student at UTMB. Let's see, I could go on and on. Jasper is probably going to go to someplace in California, but he's not doing it yet. And let's see, Sabote is also at Texas Tech. I could go on, but most of these students that have come through our lab and many other labs have been extraordinarily successful, go on to do great things at top flight medical schools, just like all of you guys are. If that's what you're looking for, if you're looking for PhD programs, I would love to talk to you about that at some point. We have a great PhD program here, but if you decide from this course that pain is your fancy, I know people all over the United States and all over the world that work in this area and hopefully can help you think about what kind of graduate school you might want to go to. Oh, there's another important thing here. Michael Burton is one of our new faculty members. He was a postdoc in my lab. He's teaching neuroimmunology. Anybody taking that course? Cool, great. So the first class was today, right? All right, so Michael's a brand new faculty. He started in the fall, and he did a postdoc with me for 2 years. So now on to the rest of the slides. Okay, so this is a painting called A Stab in the Arm. So everybody now just imagine for a second that you were just stabbed in the arm. How does that signal get to your brain? Okay, so the way that it happens is that the nociceptors that innervate the area that's injured start firing action potentials. They send a signal into the dorsal horn of the spinal cord. That then crosses after that synapse, goes on up to the brain, and sends a signal to the primary somatosensory cortex, as well as lots of other cortical structures, and tells you to protect yourself, get away from whatever it is that's hurting you, and take care of it until the tissue heals, okay? So the tissue injury is gonna cause pain hypersensitivity, which we would refer to as hyperalgesia and allodynia. Two terms we'll define more carefully in the next couple of lectures. But that's not really the problem, right? For all of us, if we have an injury like that, we understand that we need to protect the injured tissue until it heals. And once it's healed, we can go about our normal activities again. So that's not why this guy painted this painting. The reason that he painted the painting is because he had an injury, and the injury healed, and he's still feeling pain, just like he was stabbed in the arm, okay? So the question here, then, is why are these nociceptors still active, or are they still active? Well, we know that they are still active, probably, okay? So in most people that have persistent pain, if you go in and record from those, which you can do with a technique called microneurography, you can show that the C fibers are still active, okay? So most of us standing or sitting around in this room, our C fibers should be pretty much completely quiet. They might be responding to some changes in temperature, but that's about it, right? So if they're active all the time, they're going to be sending a signal to the brain that something is there that can potentially injure you. And what we really want to do is to be able to turn that off, right? So the goal of the work that we do in my lab specifically is to understand why these change their phenotype after an injury, why do they now fire action potentials all the time, and how can we use the mechanisms that we discover to potentially turn that off. Okay. So this is a picture of the Westwood Junior High 7th grade football team in 1980-something. I won't tell you. That's me. Cute, right? I was the adorable center on this football team. That is Chris Nelson. He was the quarterback of the football team. So Chris had a shoulder injury playing football when he was in high school. And that injury caused him lots of problems. He lived with it for a long time. He lived with it into his 30s. And then had a surgery to repair it, finally, okay? So he had that surgery. He started taking opioids to treat the post-surgical pain, and he became addicted. So he eventually got off the opioids. He was an executive in a bank in Seattle. And 2 years ago, he died of an opioid overdose. He's one of my best friends. It never gets easier to talk about it. So the problem with Chris was that he had a pain problem. He was not really an opioid addict, right? We talk about these people like they're opioid addicts, but Chris was a pain patient, right? He hurt his shoulder playing football. It was apparently a pretty nasty injury. He tried to live with it for a long time. As you get older, your body just breaks down. Trust me, it's true, right? My body's breaking down, right? So it happens, right? He decided at some point he was going to have the surgery, try to fix the problem. He had the surgery. He'd had pain there for a long time already. The surgery fixed the underlying problem, just like I told you about in the painting, right? But the pain just did not get any better. And that's the reason he went to have the surgery in the first place, right? He took opioids, which is what anybody would do in that situation. Having a shoulder surgery is a major surgery, right? I mean, he was probably in a sling, immobilized for 4 months or so, right? Took opioids, and he became what we would classify as addicted, but you know, he was still in pain. He was probably very tolerant from the opioids, so he was taking larger doses. He eventually got off the opioids, was going about his life. I told you, he was an executive in a bank in Seattle. So Super Bowl Sunday comes along 2 years ago, and who knows why he decided to take opioids again. So nobody knows exactly what happened, but his sister, Angie, told those of us who were dear friends with Chris for most of our lives, I knew him since I was 7, that he took the dose that he used to take. So the dose he used to take for pain was a pretty high dose because he was pretty tolerant, right? And he hadn't taken these drugs for a long time. And he took that dose. He was on his couch after the Super Bowl ended, and he died. He got respiratory depression from that dose. He probably had no idea that his tolerance was completely gone, right? So that's the danger of these drugs. They're really kind of necessary to treat pain because we don't have better things for them. They're also extraordinarily dangerous, and the way that they kill almost everybody that they kill, including my friend Chris, is respiratory depression. So he just flat out stopped breathing and died right there on his couch. So I would love to tell you that his story is what motivated me to get into this. That's not true at all, but it did change the way that I think about what the research that I do. We've changed a lot of our focus now to really push as hard as we can to take the mechanisms that we discover and turn them into medicines, okay? So what I'm gonna do in the last part of the lecture today is to tell you how we're doing that. This is gonna sound like a bit of a commercial for the companies we created. That's not really the point, okay? The point is that I want you guys to think about being entrepreneurial about what you do with your life scientifically, okay? The world needs smart people with great scientific ideas to take what they do in the laboratory and turn them into medicines. Pain is not the only area where we don't have the therapeutics that we need to treat disease, right? You guys are all neuroscience majors. Is there anything available to treat Parkinson's disease? No. Is there anything available to treat Alzheimer's disease? No. You think Big Pharma is going to solve this problem? I'm here to tell you they're not going to do anything about it, okay? So it's not because they don't care. They do care. But like, look at Pfizer, right? Pfizer is one of the biggest pharmaceutical companies in the world. Just this last week, they made the decision to get out of neuroscience research altogether. They laid off all the rest of their people that work in the neuroscience area. They don't do neuroscience anymore. Big Pharma doesn't want to do neuroscience anymore because it's too risky, right? They've developed lots of things. They've tried to take it into the clinic, and they just haven't worked. So what's the solution? I would argue to you that the solution is for you guys to be the solution. So you guys can take your ideas. You can do clinical or basic work, basic research to discover new mechanisms of disease, develop new therapeutics that can be drugs, that could be anything, devices, etc. We have great people working in device here at the Texas Biomedical Device Center. Commercialize them because that's the only way you can really take them into the clinic in large scale and help people, and you know, you get rich in the process, hopefully, right? It's a good side effect of helping lots of people is that you potentially make a lot of money off of what you do. But you know what? While you're making that money, the other thing that you're going to do is you're going to create jobs for people, right? Hopefully good, high-paying jobs. And you're going to increase the productivity and quality of life of other people that have diseases, okay? So you can also think about it from that perspective. All right, so in the lab, our goal is not really to come up with better ways to treat acute pain, although we're interested in this because that could replace opioids, for instance, for treating acute pain, but is to come up with ways to reverse the plasticity that causes this abnormal chronic pain. So the way that we go about doing this is that we almost exclusively study nociceptors, okay? These cells I was telling you about before that are in the peripheral nervous system. The reason that we study them is because we know in people that have chronic pain that the nociceptors seem to be what's called ectopically active. So they continue to fire action potentials even after the injury resolves, and that input to the brain seems to be what drives chronic pain in most cases. So oftentimes what we do is we use endogenous molecules like interleukin-6 and nerve growth factor. I'll talk to you guys in more detail about all these as we go through the slides. So today the point is not to get what these things do, it's just to get the overall concept. We study what they do to those nociceptors, how they induce these phenotypic changes, and study the pathways through which it acts. So this is one example where we're recording electrophysiology from DRG neurons in culture. So this is what's called a microelectrode array. It has a bunch of electrodes on the bottom of a dish. We grow the DRG neurons, nociceptors, in the dish, and then we record their action potentials. So if you see, focus first on the wild type neurons, that they're quiet most of the time. We expose them to IL-6. Each line is a single action potential, right? So they start firing action potentials like crazy. We take the interleukin-6 away, and they continue to fire action potentials. This lasts for a really long time, actually, about 48 hours, which is the longest we've ever looked at it. It may well last much longer than that. And we discovered through work that I'm not going to tell you about in any detail, a specific signaling pathway that we modified genetically, and then we tested whether IL-6 would have a dampened effect when we mutate that signaling pathway. So these are neurons from this mutant mouse, and you can see the result is quite striking, right? The IL-6 effect is much smaller, and when we take the IL-6 away, it's essentially gone. So we're actually now working with a small biotech company in San Diego called Effector that's made a drug that targets this pathway, and Salim Magat, a postdoc in my lab that a lot of you guys that work in my lab know very well, has been working on this for the last 6 months or so. The compound has absolutely amazing effects in animal models, so we're really excited about potentially taking this into the clinic for neuropathic pain. What's cool about this is that Effector is actually in phase 2 clinical trials for this mechanism for cancer. So we already know that the drug is safe. It cleared phase 1 clinical trials, so there's a great potential here to almost immediately take this mechanism and turn it into clinical trials for neuropathic pain, which is something that we're really interested in doing. We also use lots of other advanced genetic approaches to ascertain changes in nociceptors, and Salim, for instance, has used this translating ribosome affinity purification approach to identify a whole new mechanism that causes chemotherapy-induced neuropathy that involves a lysosomal disease. So now we're trying to target this pathway. So, you know, we just have lots of tools that we use to understand how nociceptors change their phenotype and activity. And then what we try to do as fast as we can, and again, this is really what my friend's death motivated me to change in the way that we approach research, is to push as hard as we can to find drugs or work with people that can make drugs that can target these pathways and then take them towards the clinic. So I'm not going to talk anymore about the targets, but we'll come back to some of these later. All right, so how do we actually make this start to go? Well, the key thing was for Greg and I to meet this guy, Lucas Rodriguez. So how many of you guys have met Lucas? Okay, some of you, everybody's in my lab. All right. Anybody outside of my lab had Lucas for a class? So he actually taught in bioengineering and still mentors students in bioengineering in the senior launch thing that they have, you know, where they have research projects. So Lucas was a PhD student in bioengineering, and we met him through conversations we'd had with the technology transfer office about some of the patent filings that we had. And Lucas came to us and said, hey, I want to take the technology that you guys are developing and turn it into a company. So Greg and I had been interested in doing this for a long time, but we frankly didn't know how to do it. Lucas had kind of the right mix of business education and scientific background to be able to do this, and we started. So the first thing that Lucas did was to come up with a business plan and start entering us in business competitions, and to all of our kind of amazement, we started winning these business competitions, basically right out of the box. So at the time, the company was not called Circe, it was called Resveratech. We ended up breaking it into two companies. One is Circe, and the other one is now known as Ted's Brain Science, which was not my idea, it was the marketing guys. So these two companies do different things. So Ted's Brain Science Products is a company that makes topicals for pain. We have a topical that's on the market that's ingeniously called Ted's Pain Cream. So this actually started as a company that was called Resveratech, and the cream was called Resveracream. And when we hired a marketing group right after we started the company, we had a bit of investment, all of which came from the founders of the company. So we started this by actually investing in ourselves. We met with those marketing guys, and they're like, you guys have got to get rid of this name and this. So, you know, they pitched lots of different things to us. We had like these Mad Men meetings where they would come in and give us the pitches, and eventually settled on using my name. So the reason we did that was very simple. That they said that there are no other products on the market that actually have a neuroscientist that developed it and invented it in the topical space. So we liked that idea, and therefore you either have to be Ted's or Greg's. And the reason that they like Ted's so much is because of the TED Talks. So TED already has this like positive connotation with most people. So we're just taking advantage of that accident that my parents foresaw somehow, which is cool. All right, so these are my random drawings that are on the inside of the box of our product, and now I'm going to show you a little video that explains the concept behind the cream.
Think of pain like a dinner party. With the background music turned up too loud. Most of what we feel after an injury is actually false pain. That's the music. Our nerves get oversensitive and think all signals are pain, even when they're not. The conversation between the dinner guests, that's the true pain, with important information in it, like, stop doing that or you'll break something. We need that kind of pain to avoid further injury. So what if our nerves want to have a decent conversation at this party? With most pain treatments, they can't. Some pain treatments, like opioids or lidocaine, numb everything, even the true pain. Others, like other topical treatments, just distract you with a new sensation. If a car alarm is going off next door, our guests might forget about the loud stereo for a bit. If we want to deal with the actual problem, we need a new approach. Ted's Pain Cream appears to do something nothing else does. TEDS was invented by a neuroscientist to do just what we want. Turn the stereo down, but let you still hear the guests. For the first time, we can target the false pain and eliminate it. This is a big deal. And it's why so many people that had not been able to find relief are turning to TEDS. Why not try it for yourself?
What the video does, basically, is explain the concept that what we're trying to do with this cream is to target hyperexcitable nociceptors. Okay, so all the stuff I was just telling you about, essentially what we did was we figured out that one of the best ways, marketing guys, once nociceptors become hyperactive, one of the best ways to reduce their excitability back to normal states is to activate a signaling pathway called AMP activated protein kinase. So the abbreviation for that is AMPK, right? So this is not something I'm going to go into in any detail in this class, but Basically, what we did was we started to play around with different molecules that we knew could activate AMP kinase. And we made a decision relatively early on to focus on a compound called resveratrol, which is where the name Resveratech came from. The reason we focused on resveratrol is we knew that the FDA regarded resveratrol as what's called generally regarded as safe, or GRAS. Okay? So what that means is that the FDA says resveratrol is not going to hurt anybody, so you can put it in any product that you want. So what we decided to do was to study whether or not resveratrol could reduce the excitability of nociceptors via the AMPK pathway, published several papers demonstrating that that was indeed the case, and then decided to develop this topical that contains resveratrol, which you can read more about if you want to at our website or at the papers that we published, which are a good source of the actual scientific information. So the way that we got around the fact that we have an FDA label and we're saying this is for pain is we used something that was on the FDA formulary for pain already, which is methyl salicylate or wintergreen oil. So that's what this shows. So resveratrol, if you guys have heard very much about this molecule, is the so-called good stuff in red wine, right? I think the alcohol is the good stuff in red wine, but some people argue it's the resveratrol. There's not very much of it. You'd have to drink 60 bottles of red wine in one sitting to get enough to actually get into your bloodstream and in the appreciable amount. So don't try that. However, you can purify resveratrol from a variety of different sources. And the best one to get it from is Japanese knotweed, which is where we actually get our resveratrol. And then we have wintergreen oil, which comes from the wintergreen plant. Everybody knows what wintergreen smells like, right? Yes? Okay. It smells like that because of the oil, which the chemical name for the oil is methyl salicylate. Okay? So methyl salicylate is a form of aspirin. So aspirin, which traditionally is from the willow bark tree, is salicylic acid, right? But salicylates in many different forms are the same thing. They inhibit cyclooxygenase enzymes irreversibly. That's what they've been used for thousands of years by human beings. But it's also been pretty well known that salicylates have some metabolic effects as well as some neuronal effects, which were not explained until about 2 years ago when a group published a paper in Science demonstrating that salicylates also activate AMPK. So what we did here was to take two natural products that the FDA had approved for use in a variety of different formulas that both activate AMPK. So the concept here in our topical is that we have resveratrol and methyl salicylate to activate AMPK, and then we published all this work demonstrating that if you activate AMPK, you decrease nociceptor excitability. So we tried for a while to figure out how we were going to do clinical trials, etc. Basically, we decided it was going to cost too much money, and we just decided to take it straight to the market. So we went on the market in December of last year, and some of you guys that were in my cellular neuroscience class know about this because I talked about it in the class. NPR did a story about us, and that fundamentally changed the company. We went from being a very small company that had a lot of debt to a company that had employees and was in the black in about 2 days. So since the NPR story ran in September, we've continued to do very well, and we now have tens of thousands of people that have bought our product, and I think we're going to have a chance to do a clinical trial now on our topical, but also on topicals that only contain resveratrol, and we're going to try to develop specific topicals for things like post-surgical pain that contain a high concentration of resveratrol. So this company is going to continue to try to develop things, and then this.
So I'm Greg Dusor. I'm an associate professor of behavioral and brain sciences, and I'm co-inventor of TEDS Pain Cream. We developed TEDS Pain Cream based on the peer-reviewed research that we've been conducting in the laboratory.
So you're the co-inventor of TEDS Pain Cream?
Yes, correct. So we developed TEDS Pain Cream based on the peer-reviewed research.
If you're the co-inventor, how come it's not Ted and Greg's Pain Cream?
I was told by marketing people that TEDS Pain Cream sounded better. Anyway, we developed Ted's pain cream based on the peer-reviewed work that we've been doing in the laboratory.
I don't mean to keep pressing this. I can't help but wonder how it feels to be part of this whole new discovery and then just have your name be left off.
It's fine.
So I said, it's not the pain, it's the nociceptors.
I said it was fine. I did. But I'm not fine at all. Every day is rotten. My name is
Greg.
What?
Remarkably effective at eliminating many types of pain. Though, probably not the kind of pain you feel when you help invent a new pain treatment and the marketing guys name it after your partner. Ted's Pain Cream with Resveratrol. A new way to outsmart pain.
My name is Greg.
Okay, so that's one company. The other company is Searcy Therapeutics. So what are we doing in Searcy Therapeutics? Well, we have a pipeline, which is shown here, and we're basically developing two classes of molecules to treat post-surgical pain. So the idea here is to try to develop something that can replace opioids in the post-surgical theater. Okay, so one of them is a decomposition catalyst of peroxynitrite and hydrogen peroxide. This molecule is actually in the IND enablement stage now. So what does that mean? It means it's in the very last stage before it goes into phase one clinical trials in humans. I think we're probably about 6 months away from a phase one clinical trial. Phase one is just simply safety, right? So we're gonna now give a completely new molecule for the first time to human beings, and hopefully everybody does well with it. Right? So it'll be ascending doses, and the test will basically be that their liver enzymes don't go haywire and nobody has bad side effects, and then we can move on to phase two. So this is rapidly moving along, and we're also making very specific and very potent non-natural product AMPK activators for post-surgical pain and also neuropathic pain. And here, we're a little bit farther behind, but we're a little bit farther ahead than where this slide shows. We're now doing more formulation work to move towards the clinic. So we have these two companies that have very different strategies. So how have we moved Searcy ahead? Well, we did this at the start by raising money again internally, so us investing in ourselves. But we've also now gone through an A round of funding, and we raised $2 million from NIH through small business innovation grants. So I think a lot of people don't realize that the government actually funds small businesses that are developing technologies. You don't have to raise funds through venture capitalists. You can raise funds by writing grants to the federal government, and you can get them. We have gotten some of them. So this is actually paying for the IND enablement for the compound that I was showing you. And then we've raised about $4 million from venture capital firms here in Dallas. So we're actually one of the first pharma companies in the neuroscience space in Dallas. And my hope really is that we're going to be an example of many other companies that are going to come out, hopefully run by ideas that are generated by people like you guys. Okay. So we've had a lot of experience on this, and you know, I'm not going to talk about this again in the class other than today, but if you're interested in this kind of activity, number one, I'm very interested in potentially starting a kind of neuro-entrepreneurship course next fall, so I'd love to know if you guys find that to be an interesting topic, number one. And number two, you know, as we go through the course and you're hearing about mechanisms or you're hearing about drugs that are in development, and you want to know more, this is my primary area of research, right? So this is what I'm paying attention to on an everyday basis, And I don't know everything about everything happening in all the other companies that are working on pain therapeutics, but I might know. So I would love to have discussion about that throughout the course. Okay. So I think that is the last slide for today. Well, I just want to point out one really important thing before you guys go. All the work that's done in my lab is done by really talented PhD and postdoc fellows, but a lot of it is also done by undergrads, many of whom are in this room. But all of this is made possible by the National Institute of Health. Okay, so are you guys familiar with the NIH? Yeah, all right, good. So it is a great idea to get more information about NIH funding. There is NIH funding available for undergraduate students for summer research programs and things like that that can take you to some really exciting places. So look into that. And how many of you guys have heard of loan repayment from NIH? A few of you have, but you said you didn't want to go to medical school. So if you go to medical school and then leave medical school and do research, and you know there's lots of different ways that research is defined, you can have your loans repaid, your medical school loans repaid. So learning about those early on, especially if you're interested in research. It doesn't have to be the kind of basic research that I'm engaged in. If you're interested in clinical research, et cetera, there's great opportunities along those lines to think about. You can repay, you know, hundreds of thousands of dollars in loans. All right, I'm going to stop there, and I'll see you guys on Thursday.